Okay, so this is the fifth time we are meeting, and we are going to be covering the. It's recording, right?
Yeah, 7 minutes and 6 seconds.
Okay, cool. So today we are going to be discussing the expectations, variances, what are random variables, and then I'll talk somewhat about what is a conditional probability mass function and something about the memorylessness property in geometric variables. So we have already done the discussion on discrete random variables and how the joint distributions work. So yeah. So last time I had talked about what is a random variable. So the way a random variable is generally defined is something like this. That let's say that you have a sample space with which you are beginning your experiment. So you have a sample space. Hey man, all those markers are.
I'll try the black one to the far right.
You can put those.
Yeah. All right, there
Okay.
we go.
So you are starting with a sample space, and let's say that there are some students in the classroom. So you have three crosses here which denote each of the students, and you have some students here. So let's say in this classroom there are 3, 2, 5 and 6, 7, I say 8 students here, and what you do is that you cluster them according to their heights. So each of these students have some names. So the sample space has the student as a name, which is not a number. So first what you do is that you have a mapping which essentially clusters the students together in a group, and it tells that it basically tells that all the students who belong to this group, let's say that they have a lower height, so they are assigned, let's say they are given suppose $5. So you stand outside the room, a student comes outside the room at random. And based on what is his height, you are giving him certain amount of money. So here, let's say that three students have very low height, so they only get $5. And here we have, let's say, two students who have a medium level of height. So let's say that you give them $100, and then you have three more students who are very tall, like one of them might be Stephen. So they get $1 million, okay? So what happens is that essentially you have taken your sample space. It consisted of outcomes. Each of the outcome was a not a name, was not an integer, it was a name. And you defined a mapping which converted a collection of names into a number, where the number was either $5, $100, or $1 million. And then you mapped some of the elements from the sample space to a particular number. So this number which you can see on the axis can take three values, and this number has three values which are 500 and a million, and this number denotes the dollar amounts which was given to a particular random person. So now if you're standing outside the room, the probability with which you choose a particular a particular person is 1/8, because here you can see there are 8 crosses. So then you can see that three people were given $5. So the probability of giving $5 is essentially this plus this plus this, which is a 3/8, right? And then $100 was given to two persons, and probability of choosing each of them is a 1/8. So it comes out to be 1/8 plus 1/8, which comes out to be 2/8, and then this comes out to be 3/8. So then, so essentially this was a random variable having three discrete values, and each of the values has a particular probability. And if you see that these three values can then sum up to one, which follows the probability law. And then we had discussed basically how we would go ahead and draw the probability mass function of this particular random variable. So in this case, the probability mass function would look like something like, so you have a $5 here, you have a $100 here, and you have a $1 million here. And this axis denotes the dollar amount which is given to a person, given. And The probability with which you give $5 is a 3/8. And probability with which you give $100 is basically 2/8. And with $1 million, you give it as 3/8. So the axis here denotes the probabilities, and the random variable can take 3 possible values on this curve, and these bars denote the height of the probability of an individual value, and the sum of the length of all these bars have to be 1. And these individual outcomes are discrete in nature. Okay, so this entire graph allowed us to visualize the entire probability space at the same time. So by looking at this entire graph at the same time, we can understand that what is the value of a particular outcome. So this graph is known as a probability mass function. Mass because the probabilities are concentrated at individual points, and at rest of all the other points, the probabilities are zero. So we have already discussed this thing, and today the agenda is a bit different, that we are going to be talking about some statistics of random variables. And one of the things which we have to talk for today is expectations. So what is expectation? So rather than thinking about expectations in a mathematical sense, let's try to build something intuitively. So basically what happens is that in nature, you are given a probabilistic experiment. You go ahead and perform that experiment many times. You get some values, and then you average them out. So for example, let's say that I roll a dice. So I roll that dice many times. Whatever I see on the top, I note that down on a piece of paper, and I take all the values and I average them out. So that is what is expectation, right? So if that is our intuition, that expectations are nothing but averages of the random variables, how does it translate to some formulas in the probabilities? So consider a case in which we are talking about a pen is not working. Okay. So consider a case in which we are talking about that.
Yeah, hopefully. Let's grab that one.
Okay. So for example, we are talking about the biased dice. So in a biased dice, let's say that one of the faces comes with a higher probability. So what happens is that we have several possible faces, and let's say that the face third comes with a higher probability of maybe a half, okay? And the rest, so let's say that maybe it's a four-face dice, because we have been dealing with four-face dice in all of our experiments till now. So let's say that probability of getting a 3 is maybe a quarter. Probability of getting a 4 is maybe a quarter. And then instead of this being a half, okay, just a moment. How should we distribute this? So, okay, let's talk about equal probabilities for now. So let's say that we have a dice which is four-faced dice, and all of the values can occur equally likely, okay? So here what will happen is that, suppose for example, you rolled this die 100 times. So what does this say? This says that when I rolled it 100 times, it means that quarter of times, so out of 100, 25 times value 1 came, 25 times value 2 came, 25 times value 3 came, and 25 times value 4 came, right? So if I look at the top of the topmost face, so 25 times 1 had come, right? So 25 times 1 had come, and then 25 times 2 had come, and 25 times 3 had come, and similarly for the fourth phase, and the total number of rolls which I had made had been 100, right? So here, if you can look, what I am basically doing is that I can separate, so this is the way I would have taken the averages, right? That I would have assumed a certain number of roles, and then I would have assumed, I would have calculated how many times each of them occurred, and then I would have just summed up the number on the top of the dice. So here I could separate this term out, something like this. So you can see the 25 by 100 factor comes common to all of these, and 1 and 2 and 3 come out. So I could write this as 25 by 100 times 1, 25 by 100 times 2, plus 25 by 100 times 3, plus 25 by 100 times 4, right? So what is this? This is basically the average, on average, what is the number which I expect on top of the dice once I roll is, I look at the probability with which one occurs, and I multiply it by the value which can appear on the top of the dice, which is 1. And I add to it the probability with which 2 occurs. And then I look at the topmost face, which can be 2, and so on. Okay? So this is what expectation is. So basically, we take the possible values of the random variable. So in this case, it had been 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then we also add to it, and we multiply each of the individual values by the probabilities with which the individual outcomes occur. Okay, so this is one of the ways. So these are two possible ways in which we can interpret expectations. The first way is we assume that the experiment occurred 100 times, and then we get these 25 numbers, and then we assume that, okay, in 25 rules, what is the number of times, what did I get? I got 1. So I multiply 25 by 1. And then I took a frequency-based approach in which I counted the number of outcomes which result, like whatever came in 100 outcomes, and I divided that by 100, okay? This is the first approach. The second way to understand expectations is that we look at individual values of the random variable, and we just weigh the individual value with the probability of how much it occurs. So here, like 4 occurs with a probability of 1/4. 3 occurs with the probability of 1/4, so it would essentially become 1 over 4 times 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. This is the second way to understand the expectation. The third way to understand the expectation is something like this. So, if I look at this graph is pretty much symmetric, okay? So the center of mass of this graph is something which should come out to be the expectation, okay? So in case you are someone who loves physics, so in physics there is a concept like what is the equivalent point in a rigid body on which, if a force applies, is equivalent to forces applying on all the random points in the body. So that point can essentially act as approximation for the entire rigid body. So that particular point is what is the expectation, that particular point is what is known as, will be where the expectation lies, assuming that at all the individual points of the body, the probability mass is pretty much focused. So for example, here everything is focused. We can see 4 points. So our intuition is that the center of mass of this should lie somewhere here, which is this point 2.5, right? So if you solve this guy, so 4 plus 3 is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So 10 divided by 4, which comes out to be 5 over 2, which comes out to be 2.5, okay? So this is 2.5, okay? And now, suppose the dice becomes biased, and what happens is that 3 starts turning up with a higher probability than these two guys. So then the center of mass will shift from 2.5 towards 3, okay? So you can understand the expectation in terms of a center of mass point, and then if one of the probabilities perturbs away from the uniform distribution, the other probabilities fall off, and the movement of center of mass changes towards the way, towards the direction where the body is starting to become more heavier. Okay, so these are the three possible interpretations in which we can understand what is the expectation. Okay, so one is the frequency based approach, one is the probability which I told you, and the third is the center of mass of rigid bodies. So any doubts in this? Does this make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
Stephen, perfect?
Yeah, no, you're golden so far.
Okay. So if like whatever I have told you, then it seems that this formula starts to make sense. So all the possible values which the random value variable can take, so and for each of the possible values, we take that value and we multiply it by its probability and we sum up all these terms. So this talks about all the possible values which a variable can take. So here the random variable is a capital X. Capital X is the all the possible rolls of the die. The small x denotes all the possible values which capital X can take, which are 1, 2, 3, 4 here. And for each of these values, we take the value which came at top of the dice and we multiply it by the individual probability. So this is what the expectation appears to be. So this formula, you can imagine to be generalized for any discrete case where a random variable can take several values, but the probabilities need not be uniform, they can be pretty much different, okay? And my notion of center of mass, of expectation lying at the center of mass only holds if the body is pretty much uniform. If it is non-uniform, then it will shift towards the higher density region, okay? Yeah, so these 2 points should be pretty much clear. So next, then one of the problem which generally comes is the functions of, is basically understanding the functions of expectations. So what the functions of random variables and calculating their expectations. So what I mean by this is something as follows. So which marker worked? Hey man.
Fingers crossed.
I have to keep on doing the marker thing. Okay.
Yeah, put it in your pocket that way.
Yeah.
You'll get a new one after Thanksgiving, worst case scenario.
Okay. So what I talked about was that I had drawn this figure that we had three children here, and two children here, and we were mapping these guys to $5, $100, and $1,000,000. Maybe I will say that as $1,000, and we were mapping them here. So this probability came out to be 3 over 8, 2 over 8, and 3 over 8. Okay? So here. So now this is the distribution which occurred, and this was the first random variable where we were talking about the dollar amounts. So now let's say that somebody went ahead and they are interested in giving. A company comes to college and it gives job to poor people and not the rich people. So it tells that all the people who got less than $500 would be given a job since they are pretty much broke. And all the people who had $1,000 are pretty much rich, so they don't need job. They can do away with the internship. So all the people who are less than $500, so basically all the people who got either $5 or $100 were given a job. And by given a job, I mean that let's say that the random variable took a value 1. 1 means that the person got a job, and he got a job with probability 3 by 8 plus 2 by 8, which is 5 by 8. And the people who didn't get the job were essentially people who got $1,000, which and their probability was 3 over 8. So this directly mapped, and this was 3 over 8. Okay? So what is the probability that a person got a job? It was 5 over 8. What is the probability that a person didn't get a job? It was 0 over 8. It was 3 over 8, right? So this random variable, if I plot a PMF of this, it can take the PMF in. So if I draw a PMF of this, the job variable was either 0 or a 1, and the value it took was a 5/8 and a 3/8, right? And if I calculate the expectation, so what is the expected value that a person got a job? It would be 0 times 3 over 8 plus 1 times 5 over 8, right? Which is equal to this 0 will cancel out and this will give us a 5 over 8. Okay? So now do you understand what is the problem? The problem is that if I was talking about, if I was trying to find on average what is the probability that a person, like how many people got a job, then I would have to first perform this mapping and then I would have to do this thresholding thing and I will have to aggregate the probabilities again. And for the final variable, I will have to draw a PMF and then I will have to calculate the expectation. So this seems to be a pretty difficult thing to do, right? Because it is a two-step process in which what we are doing is that we are calculating the probability of the final thing, which is a 5 over 8, and we are weighing it according to the value which it could take, which was 1. Okay, so what is an alternate way in which we could have calculated this expectation? The alternate way would have been to not do the two-step thing. We could only stick with the one-step process. The one-step process would be something like this, that I will just look at the sample space, okay? I'll just look at the sample space, I won't do all this thing. And I'll ask myself the question, so which of these people do we think that gave us $500? Like, which of these two guys was earning less than $500? So it comes out to be a bigger set of these, right? So this is 5 over 8. Right, and this two things are 2 over 8. So now, by just looking at the sample, at the initial sample space, I was able to understand that there were some people who formed a larger set whose size was 5, and there were some people who formed a smaller set whose size was 3. Right, and I could directly evaluate these probabilities now. So basically what mathematically it means is that when we start an experiment, each of the outcome has an individual probability, okay, and then we map it first to get the individual random variable values, and then we are mapping it again, and we are interested in so this is the first point at which the random variable is defined. And then we are introducing a transformation, a function on this, which is essentially mapping some of these values to a particular new value. So we started from x and we map it through g to another function g of x. And we are interested in evaluating the expectation of g of x. We could calculate it in two ways. Either we first we first try to come up with the PMF of g of x, right, which was this. Or what we say is that for a particular value of g of x, which is 1, what are all the possible values of x which satisfy that? So here the people who got the job was 5 people, and I could directly add their own probabilities. So I don't have to do this mapping process, I can essentially take the sum of these 5 things. Okay, so this is what this is telling us. So if x is a random variable, so x was this thing, and y is g of x, so y is this transformation which we made. Basically, if we had to calculate the expectation of this, then I had to first do this probability summation and get 5 over 8. So this summation of probabilities is an additional overhead to me to get this new PMF, which is 5 over 8 and 3 over 8. So instead, what we can do is, we have a formula which allows us to work with the original PMF. What is the original PMF? The original PMF is 1, 2, 3. So all of 8 people being equally distributed with probability 1 over 8. We could just use that particular PMF, and we could apply the transformation g of x to each particular x. So here we can work with the original PMF, and then we can use the g of x as a particular value. So what this formula is saying is that this person could be chosen with a probability 1 over 8. That is fine. Okay. So 1 over 8 multiplied by what does this person take value as? This person took a value 1, like he got a job. Plus 1/8 times, what did this person do? This person got a job, so he took the value 1, right? So I took 1/8, 1/8, 1/8 and a value of 0 or 1 respectively. So I am sticking with the 1/8, which is the initial PMF. I no longer need to calculate this PMF, which is 5/8, okay? So you can see that here, if I use the initial PMF, it would be 1/8 and there are 5 such people, right? So one, if I look at this guy, he got a job, right? So his probability of getting chosen was 1/8 and he got a job, so it was a 1, right? And I was doing this process for 5 times since there were 5 such people. So I could multiply this entire thing by 5. Okay? So you can see, and plus there were each of this person didn't get a job, right? So it was a 0. And his probability of getting chosen was 1/8 and there were 3 such people. So you can see that this entire thing comes out to be 5/8 plus 3/8 times 0, which is again 5/8. So this 5/8 and this 5/8 are same. But now this process is pretty much easy because I know that my x has a particular distribution and I just applied the transformation g of x to each particular value and I can work with the same PMF. I no longer need to calculate a new PMF. Okay? Yeah. So is this part clear or any doubt in this?
Any square.
Okay, so why is this easy and why do we care about this? So you imagine something like this, that you have a neural network and that neural network is applying a particular transformation g of x to an input x. Okay, then you shouldn't basically look at, so we are not interested, we are trying to understand that on average what is the output which comes out of the neural network. Okay. So what we can do it in two ways. We can look at the output of neural network, count how many times what is coming, and then average that out. This seems to be difficult, right? What we could do is take as, so you know the input distribution and you know what is the function which the neural network evaluates. So the neural network function is g of x and the input distribution is x. So you can directly get the value, expected value of the output. You no longer need to perform the experiment again. So this is why this formula helps us. And this becomes difficult because, for example, his GPT model, what he was talking, I couldn't put it on a single machine to evaluate this expectation. But this expectation I could because I know what is the model's function. How? I know the weights which a network is modeling and I could basically put that weights as a polynomial, a non-linear polynomial. So this x, g of x, I already know. Okay, so for a neural network, you know g of x, you know x, and you can use directly this formula to get the expectation of the output. And here you would have to run it at the, so here you would have to look at the output, count individual values again, and this would have been a tough task to do, right? Cool. So now there are some, so to build your intuition about the expectations, what do you think the expectation of a constant should be? So expectation of a constant is something like this, that I have a dice of only one face, I throw it and it always turns up a same face. So on average, what is the value which I get? Whatever is written on the dice, right? If I have a dice on which 2 is written, I'll get 2, right? So expectation of a constant has to be a constant. The same thing, like if I have a constant, basically the way I will draw its PMF is that it has a value alpha and it takes a value 1, right? It doesn't give me any information, it's purely deterministic experiment. But if I write its expectation, it's the value multiplied by probability which comes out to be a constant, and it aligns with our intuition of the example I just gave. Therefore, the expectation of a constant has to be the constant itself. Okay? Okay, cool. Now, let's talk about another case. What's the expected value of alpha times x? So, what does alpha times x mean? So, imagine for a moment that I have a dice, that dice is fair, and I roll it every time, the dice is fair. So it has some distribution like all the 1-6 in the curve. And now the dice was having numbers like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But now I'm going ahead and multiplying each of the numbers by 2. So instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, it's maybe 2, 4, 6, 8 on the top of dice. So what's the number which I will end up on the top of dice? So basically, whatever it was in the earlier case, it's essentially getting multiplied by 2, right? So if you look at it mathematically, so it aligns to some situation like this.
So the expectation is a linear transformation.
So it, just a moment. So it aligns to something like this. So in, let's say you had a four-sided dice and it had values 1, 2, 3, 4, and these all had quarter probabilities. It's a four-sided die. Now you multiply each of the faces by 2, so your PMF got shifted to a new value, which is somewhere here, 2, 4, 6, 8, and the values are still 1 over 4, right? Because the dice has these two faces, these four faces, and it's having the same nature. So the expectation has to be at the center because it's the distribution, so it has to be here at 5. Right? Earlier the expectation was here at the center, which was 2.5. So every value here was multiplied by 2, that's why this expectation got multiplied by 2. So therefore, if I have a random variable and I multiply each of its realization by a value alpha, it's basically nothing. It's like the distribution is shifting by alpha amounts to the right, and as a result the entire body is like it's a single body which is moving towards the right as a y. So therefore the center of mass of that body has to move, or wherever the expectation was lying, even if it's non-uniform in nature. So here the answer has to be pretty much the alpha times expectation of x, right? So in our case, alpha is 2, expectation of x is 2.5. I was multiplying everything by 2, and expectation of a normal dice was 2.5. So 2 times 2.5 is giving us a 5. Okay. Now let's talk about a general case, which is basically this guy. Expectation of alpha x plus beta. So first let's talk about expectation of alpha x, which is pretty much clear, right? And if I add beta to this, this is nothing but I am increasing the number on each of these by a certain amount. So I have a dice, I multiply twice, every face on it by twice. So the expectation moved somewhat, right? And then I increase the number on the dice. So it means that this body, so if I'm increasing the number by 1 on every face, so the new values are 3, 5, 7, 9, right? So this body is moving forward by 1 amount, right? So the expectation is also moving forward by 1 amount, okay? So when I multiplied by alpha, the expectation multiplied itself. And when I increased the values of each of these guys, the expectation shifted towards right. So expectations essentially are a linear phenomenon. So what does this mean is that you could decompose this as alpha times expectation of x plus beta. Okay? You understand this? So to be more precise, the way I could write this is expectation of alpha x plus expectation of beta, and expectation of alpha x using this property comes out to be alpha times expectation of x plus expectation of beta, and beta is a constant, so expectation of beta is nothing but beta using the first property. So it comes out to be alpha times expectation of x plus beta. Okay? So why is this necessary? Again, think of a neural network. A neural network has the first layer as a linear layer. So if you know the initial layer, initial distribution of x, you can find the expectation value of the first layer. Guaranteed the things screw up after the non-linearities, but we have a method of analyzing those also. But if you know the distribution of x, you can find the expectation of their products and translations. Okay, it's just a matter of scaling. So alpha x means x gets, so this distribution was, what was the span of this? 4 minus 1, 3, right? Then I doubled all the values. So it started from 2, ended at 8. So the span moved from 3 to 6, right? The span has increased, okay? So alpha means that the distribution values are same, but the span has increased, okay? And then when I am shifting it by beta, it means that it acts as a single rigid body whose dimensions don't change. It only translates along the axis. So alpha means a scaling operation and beta means a translation operation. Okay, so this is the stuff which we need to take away from here. So right now I have not talked about, like I am only talking about one particular thing, which is this center. Okay, but is this enough? Is this enough for analyzing a distribution? So for example, imagine that I give you two distributions. So one of the distribution is starting at 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, okay? And it's starting, it's maybe having a half probability here, a quarter probability here, and a quarter probability here, okay? And let's put the things a bit simpler. So let's imagine an equal distribution, 1 over 3, 1 over 3, and 1 over 3. So where do you think the expectation of this body will lie? It's a rigid body having three things. All the things are equal, so expectation has to be at the center of 2. And now let me build another system which is operating on this same guy, but I'll change the probabilities somewhat. So here, instead of 1 over 3, I'm reducing the probabilities to 1 over 5th. So here, the body is still equal. All the probabilities are equal. There are 5 values. So expectation again has to lie at the center, right? Which is a 2 here and 2 here. So it means that expectation is not enough. Because you can see, if someone just told me that expectation of a distribution is 2, then there could have been two possible distributions, at least two possible distributions, which resulted in this expectation. So given only the expectation, I could not reconstruct the distribution. Okay? Like if someone told me that expectation of a distribution is 2, and he didn't know these arrows, could you tell me what was the distribution? No, right? It could have been any damn thing. So it seems to us that expectation, although it gives us an idea of where the things so some things are greater than expectations, some things are greater than 2, which are 3, some things are lesser than 2, which is 1. So on average they are 2, but it does not give us the idea about the entire distribution. So that's why people tend to characterize them in a better way, which is what we call as variance. So basically what variance does is that it measures that from the mean, how much far away are all the particular values. So here, for example, if I look at this guy, so this guy had a distribution of health expectation at 0.2, and the possible values it took was 1 and 3 and 2, right? So if I got 1, it was 1 distance away from 2, right? And if I got a 3, so let's talk about this example. This will be a bit easier to understand. So here the expectation was 2. So what are the other values I got? I got a value 0, 1, 3, 4, right? From this point, the values are how much far away? They are 1 distance, they are 2 distance. So here also it's 1 distance, here also it's 2 distance, right? So this particular value was 1 distance away and this particular value was 2 distance away. So if I manage to understand that, okay, what is the rough distance by which the values are away from me, I can get a measure of the spread of the distribution, okay? So here, like, this particular distance is 1. With what probability this distance is occurring? With the same probability, this value is 1, because this 1 minus this mean is giving me 1. So this one is occurring with a 1/5 probability, okay? So 1/5 times, man, the pens are all gone. Hey, do you have an alternate pen?
I do not.
It seems the semester is ending and the pens are also ending.
Yes. Do any of them have anything left in them?
I don't think so.
I remember that like there was like a technique to get like...
What, shaking it perhaps, or...?
Not shaking, but like putting like in a roof and doing like this.
Oh, spinning it around and agitated, I know what you mean.
Okay, so here the distances which we are getting, so from the mean, the values can be away from the mean by certain amounts, and we are measuring on average what is the distance which can come. So here the distance is 1, and 1 with a probability of 1/5. I can't write here. Okay. So we are talking something like this, that we have a distribution in which we have possible values as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it can take a probability of 1 over 5 for all of these, right? So if I look at the mean of this is 3. And I'm interested in knowing that from the mean, how far are all the possible values which I get, okay? So here, if I get a 5, so it's basically 2 distance away from this. And if I get a 2, it's basically 1 distance away from this. So what I could do is basically measure the distance, okay? So the distance is something like this. So I get 1, so I get this 1, and I get this 1. So there are 2 ones which I get with a probability of 1 over 5. So 1 is how I get it by.